So today we want to do something which we normally never do, namely talk the entire episode only about one topic, and that is the Artemis moon landing program, to be more precise, the entire Artemis moon landing timeline. Now, only 1 week ago, Jim Bridenstine gave a pretty excellent speech at the NASA Michoud Facility in New Orleans, you know, down on the bayou.
This speech was so well done and epic that even we, as critics of SLS, were even inspired and thought, why not analyze the highlights of Jim Bridenstine's speech? How and when will they land? And what's the long-term timeline for creating a permanent presence of humans on the moon?
And this time we will even try not to mention Starship by name, and we promise we won't make fun of SLS, like we try to pull ourselves together, okay? So then I would say let's start.
As you know us, normally we like to make fun of the SLS. Not because we don't like NASA, or Jim Bridenstine, or Douglas Loverro. Nah, actually we like NASA. Their science programs are amazing. The rovers they have on Mars are invaluable. The probes they send to the outer solar system are amazing. We have to thank NASA for so many fascinating discoveries. And Jim Bridenstine also seems like a quite friendly and intelligent guy. The speech he gave last week at the NASA Michoud Rocket Facility in New Orleans was excellent. And Douglas Loverro, the new head of NASA's Human Spaceflight Division, also seems like a quite friendly and intelligent guy. So why then do we still like make so often fun of the SLS?
Well, because it basically represents an outdated technology and is designed to keep them dollars flowing to the likes of Boeing and Lockheed, you know, to the contractors. Which are, let's formulate it mildly, not really efficient and not really hell-bent on making this thing actually fly and bringing it into space as soon as possible, you know? More the contrary, more like dragging it out as long as possible to keep them dollars flowing and flowing and to milk NASA as long as possible. But okay, we said we will hold ourselves back. Okay. So let's try in this video to analyze the most interesting points that Jim Bridenstine and Douglas Loverro said during last week's speech at the SLS core stage completion event at NASA's Michoud facility. So after an extremely long introduction where a lot of senators were gloriously praised, Jim began to talk about the core stage completion of the SLS rocket and what a historic moment that was. Then he immediately went on speaking about the Artemis mission and began emphasizing that this time NASA's return to the moon would be a sustainable approach and that contrary to the Apollo era, this time the mission would be to stay on the moon.
He went on to detail on the timeline of the Artemis missions and what we can expect in the coming years. The completed SLS central core, which we can see here in the background, will actually be the one to launch the uncrewed Artemis 1 mission in late 2020, if current plans hold. The Artemis 1 mission will be an uncrewed moon round trip, whereas the first crewed round trip around the moon will take place sometime in 2022, according to current plans. So basically the Apollo 8 of our time. Then the first crewed landing on the moon should take place with the Artemis 3 mission in 2024, where the first woman and the next man will land near the lunar South Pole. The South Pole is of course a much more interesting area than Apollo landing sites, because massive water ice reserves are known to exist there, which will of course play a crucial role for future moon bases. Bridenstine of course had to explain the importance of the Lunar Gateway for the whole Artemis moon mission approach, as it would enable commercial or international partners to dock to the gateway and then launch common surface missions from there. This is quite interesting since this is the first time that we heard about international moon missions, maybe even using commercial moon landers at the same time. The gateway will also serve as a communications relay, with the possibility of relaying data from the far side of the moon for radio astronomy, as the far side of the moon is extremely radio quiet and offers the possibility for high precision radio astronomy. The Dapper mission will do exactly that. And Bridenstine mentioned that due to the Gateway acting as a relay station, the costs for the Dapper mission will be drastically reduced.
Now, after the speech, some quite interesting questions were asked, with the first one immediately targeting reusability, with this guy asking here, at what point will NASA switch to use reusable rockets? Now, Jim Bridenstine immediately answered by saying, even though SLS won't be reusable, the other components of the Artemis program, such as the Gateway, the Orion, and the Lunar Lander, will be reusable. So his logic was kind of like, okay, the SLS is not reusable and generates a lot of trash, expensive trash. However, at least the Gateway, the Lander, and the Orion, so the other components of the Artemis program, are reusable. So non-reusability kind of enables reusability. And long term, he said, of course, NASA will have to go to full reusability. But he didn't provide any details whatsoever. You know, of course, what we think of this, but we promise not to say anything in this video, and we will stick to that promise. And of course, what else can Jim Bridenstine say about SLS? He has to paint SLS in a positive way during that speech. I mean, this is clear, right? Now, Douglas Loverro, the new chief of the human spaceflight branch of NASA, also went up on the stage and again re-emphasized that he is absolutely 100% hellbent on really making the 2024 target date. He even has a pin on his suit with a countdown timer to the Artemis 3 moon landing, which on that day was at T-minus 1849 days. I really have to say I like this guy's optimism and positive attitude and can-do mentality. This is pretty cool and pretty contagious somehow. Even I am starting now to believe more and more that NASA will be actually able to deliver on their promise and actually land on the moon in 5 years. So if Douglas Loverro, with his optimism and positive attitude, can make it happen, then we're all for it.
Jim Bridenstine again took over, answering further questions. For example, if cargo for the crewed Artemis missions would be deployed beforehand. Interestingly, he didn't mention any specific company, but he spoke about commercial partners or companies with moon landers ready, which could, for example, deploy pressurized rovers beforehand as part of the commercial lunar payload services program. We only know one lunar lander which will be capable of delivering such large payloads. But we promise not to mention it by name this time. And a promise is a promise. When asked about the brutal costs of one SLS being $1.5 to $2 billion, he answered that the price would go down if NASA would order more than one SLS from Boeing. He sees the price dropping to only $800 million if NASA would order 10 SLS rockets from Boeing, which apparently they intend to do if they can get approval from Congress. Still a brutal price, but well, they have to please senators such as Shelby from Alabama, right? Currently, only two SLSs are ordered by contract, and they try to push for a third one. But this entirely depends on the budget approval by Congress.
So what really positively surprised us and what we really liked was that Jim said that should NASA not get the necessary appropriation from Congress to move on with the Artemis program, that NASA would actually want to find ways to move on even without this appropriation. So for example, he said that there are certain companies working on moon landers which could be made use of in case they won't get the necessary appropriation. And what we liked even more is when he suddenly said, like, they might have to talk to lawyers to find ways, legal ways, to make a moon landing happen by 2024 with all means within a regulatory framework, of course, so 100% legal, but still they would have to find some loopholes by talking to lawyers to still make it happen, even if they shouldn't get appropriation from Senate. Now, I don't know how realistic that is, but it's freaking awesome that he's even saying this. So he said that in case they wouldn't get the appropriation, NASA would have to become really, really creative and find any means, any legal means, of course, possible to still make the moon landing happen by 2024. And like this attitude, this positive attitude, I haven't heard it before with NASA, and this is like the first time we hear something like this. So correct me if I'm wrong, but this sounds really extremely aggressive, like they really want to make it happen this time. And he also said something which sounded like music. Music to our ears. Take a listen.
I am the first NASA administrator that doesn't have a memory of where he was when Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin walked on the moon. I don't have that memory because I was not alive yet. That is a generational failure. And by the way, we had 6 missions that landed on the moon up until 1972. I don't have a memory of any of them because I wasn't born until 1975. We have to make sure that another generation does not go by where we don't have people living and working on another world.
This is pretty epic stuff coming from a NASA chief, and I haven't heard this before ever, like since I'm like following what NASA is doing, so since 20 years, I haven't seen a NASA chief being so optimistic and enthusiastic and aggressively pursuing a target. So I don't know, maybe this time they will actually make it. I'm starting kind of to believe it more and more, and outside there's brutal wind. I'm sorry for that. What the f-
So let's take a look at the official Artemis PDF. We will put the link into the description also to get an idea of the whole timeline and how it might happen. According to this plan, we will see the uncrewed Artemis 1 mission in late 2020 and the crewed Artemis 2 moon round trip mission in 2022 with SLS and Orion. From 2022 to 2024, the Lunar Gateway will be assembled using commercial rockets. Falcon Heavy will make the most sense for that in our opinion, since it has the highest lunar payload capability among all launch systems which are already available today. And the Falcon Heavy will still have the highest payload capability after the SLS by that time. But SLS will be only utilized for the main Artemis missions, as far as we know. Correct us if we are wrong. So Falcon Heavy would make a lot of sense to deliver the Lunar Gateway component and the lunar lander. Then in 2024, we would see the first crewed Artemis landing on the surface near the lunar south pole. That would conclude Artemis Phase 1. In Phase 2, starting by 2025, further Artemis missions will be conducted, and the Lunar Gateway will be gradually expanded to become a larger space station. Habitat shelters would be deployed in parallel between Artemis 6 and Artemis 7.
So even though some specifics of the entire Artemis timeline are still a bit vague and we don't know exactly which private company will do what and what NASA will do and everything is not fully fleshed out yet, but we still have to say we kind of like the entire timeline as it looks pretty doable and pretty realistic. I mean, sure, we aren't fans of the whole gateway idea and the SLS. You know that already, we said it plenty of times. But I mean, at least we might really get to see people walking on the moon again this time, which is really already quite something. And Jim and Douglas's epic speeches certainly made us a bit more optimistic. I mean, of course, it will be interesting to see how this thing here, which I promised not to mention by name, will disrupt the entire timeline or what influence it might have on the whole Artemis timeline. This will be very, very interesting indeed to see. But we have talked about it a lot and we will certainly talk about it even more in future videos. But suffice it to say for this time that let's just see how things will develop, and either way, we are pretty like happy with the Artemis timeline and it looks actually not so unrealistic. I mean, either way, no matter which vehicle will then in the end really bring astronauts to the moon by 2024, we would be super freaking happy to really see astronauts on the moon in 5 years again. Either way, we would be freaking super happy.
Wow, it was really hard not to mention it by name. So, you know, this big shiny thing with fins, wings, or flaps, or whatever.
And do you actually think that NASA could actually really land on the moon by 2024?
Or are we just too easily influenced by epic speeches and being too optimistic now?
We certainly are easily influenced by epic speeches, so this could have something to do with it.
We are still quite skeptical about SLS bringing humans back to the moon. but now a bit more optimistic, right? After the speech.
Yeah, a bit more optimistic. So then be sure to subscribe and turn on that famous notification bell. Bell, you know, it's important.
Yes, so you don't miss any of our future uploads with our honest opinions on spaceflight and also electric cars. And other new technologies, of course, sometimes.
Absolutely right. So then, see you next time.